أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إن المسلمين والمسلمات والمؤمنين والمؤمنات والقانتين والقانتات والصادقين والصادقات والصابرين والصابرات والخاشعين والخاشعات والمتصدقين والمتصدقات والصائمين والصائمات والحافظين فروجهم والحافظات والذاكرين الله كثيرا والذاكرات أراد الله لهم مغفرة وأجرا عظيما بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي Honorable Justice M.M. Qazi, respected elders and my dear brothers and sisters, I welcome all of you with the Islamic greetings. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Meaning, may peace, blessings and mercy of Almighty Allah be on all of you. The topic for today's day is the women's rights in Islam, modernizing or outdated. According to the Oxford Dictionary, women's rights are the rights that promote a position of social and legal equality of women to men. According to the Oxford Dictionary, they are the rights claimed for the women equal to those of men as regards to suffrage, that's the right to vote, as regards to property, etc. Modernizing, according to the Oxford Dictionary, means to make modern, to adapt to modern needs or habits. And according to the Webster's Dictionary, it means to make modern or to give a new character or appearance. Example, to modernize one's ideas. In short, modernizing is a process of updating or opting for the betterment of the present status itself. It is not the present modern status itself. Can we modernize ourselves to master our problems and to realize a new way of life for the whole human race? I'm not concerned about the modern ideas, the conclusions and the categorical statements made by scientists and unexperienced armchair experts as how a life should be lived by a woman. I'm going to base my conclusions and considerations on truth, which can be proved by experience. Experience and unbiased factual holistic analysis are the sure test between the gold of truth and the glitter of theory. We have to check our thinking against reality. Otherwise, many a times our mental process will go astray. Indeed, the great brains of one time believed that the world was flat. If we agree with the women's rights in Islam as portrayed by the Western media, you have no option but to agree that the women's rights in Islam are outdated. The Western talk of women's liberation is actually a disguised form of exploitation of a body, deprivation of honor, and degradation of a soul. The Western society, which speaks of upgrading the status of women in Islam, have actually reduced her status to concubines, to mistresses, to society butterflies, which are mere tools in the hands of sex marketeers and pleasure seekers, which are disguised behind the colorful skin of art and culture. Islam's radical revolutionary support gave women their due right and status in the days of the ignorance 1400 years ago. Islam's objective was and continues to be to modernize our thinking, our living, our seeing, our hearing, our feeling, and striving for the women's upliftment and emancipation in the society. Before I dwell further into the topic, I would like you to make note of a few points. The first point is that approximately 1/5 of the world's population consists of Muslim. There are different Muslim societies. Some may be close to Islam, some may be far away from Islam. The women's rights in Islam should be judged according to the authentic sources and not what individual Muslims do or what the Muslim society does. The authentic sources of Islam are the Quran, which is the word of God, and the authentic Sunnah and the tradition of our beloved Prophet, may peace be upon him. Point number 4. The Quran will never contradict itself, nor will the Sahih Hadith contradict itself. Neither will these two authentic sources contradict each other. Point number 5. Sometimes the scholars differ, and many times these differences can be removed by analyzing the Quran as a whole and not just by quoting one particular verse. Because if one particular verse of the Quran, if it's ambiguous, many a times the answer is given somewhere else in the Quran. Some people quote one source and neglect all the other sources. And the last point is, it's the duty of every Muslim, male or female, to seek the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to act as his trustee on this world, and not to try and gain fame or to satisfy one's own ego. Islam believes in equality of men and women. Equality does not mean identicality. In Islam, the role of a man and woman, it is complementary. It is not conflicting. It is that of a partnership. It's not contradictory, so as to strive for supremacy. Where women's rights in Islam is concerned, I have divided into 6 broad categories. The first are the spiritual rights. Second are the economical rights. Third are the social rights. Fourth are the educational rights. Fifth are the legal rights. And last are the political rights. Let's analyze the spiritual rights of women in Islam. The greatest misconception that the West has about Islam is that they think paradise in Islam is only meant for the male. It is not meant for the female. This misconception can be removed by quoting from Surah Nisa, chapter number 4, verse number 124, which says, وَمَنْ يَعْمَلْ مِنَ الصَّالِحَاتِ مِنْ ذَكَرٍ أَوْ أُنْسَى وَهُوَ مُؤْمِنٌ فَأُولَٰئِكَ يَدْخُلُونَ الْجَنَّةَ وَلَا يَظْلِمُونَ نَقِيرًا. Which means, if any of you do deeds of righteousness, whether it be male or a female, and have faith, they shall surely enter paradise, and not the least injustice shall be done to them. A similar thing is repeated in Surah An-Nahl, chapter number 16, verse number 97, which says, if any of you perform good deeds, be it a man or a woman, and is a believer, we shall give you good life, and we should reward you for all your good works. Just because in Islam, sex is not the criteria to enter paradise, will you call such rights in Islam as modernizing or outdated? Another misconception is that which the Western media has, that the women have no soul. In fact, it was in the 17th century when the Council of Wise Men, when they gathered at Rome, and they unanimously agreed that the woman had no soul. In Islam, man and woman have the same spiritual nature. And that was clarified by our young Qari, Brother Ashraf Mahmoudi, who recited the verse from Surah Nisa, chapter number 4, verse number 1, which says, Ya ayyuhan nas tattaqu rabbakum alladhi khalaqakum min nafsin wahidatin khalaqa minha zawjaha. Which means that all humankind, reverence your guardian Lord who has created you from a single person and created like nature his mate. A similar thing is mentioned in Surah Nahl, chapter number 16, verse number 32, which says that we have made for you companions and mates of your own nature. Again, in Surah Al-Shura, chapter number 42, verse number 11, it says, فَاتُرُ سَمَوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضَ جَعَلَ لَكُمْ مِنْ أَنفُسِكُمْ أَزْوَاجًا. He is the one who has created the heavens and the earth and has made for you pairs from among yourselves. Just because the spiritual nature of a man and woman is the same in Islam, will you call such rites in Islam as modernizing or outdated? The Quran clearly mentions that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has breathed somewhat of his spirit into the human beings. If you read Surah Hijr, chapter number 15, verse number 29, it says, when I have fashioned you in due proportion and I breathed into you something of my spirit, fully down in obedience. A similar thing is repeated in the Quran, in Surah Sajda, chapter number 32, verse number 9, which says, ثُمَّ صَوَّهُ وَنَفَخَ فِيهِ مِنْ رُوحِهِ. Means, we have fashioned you in due proportion and I've breathed into you something of my spirit. Here, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala refers to as something of my spirit is breathed into the human beings, it does not mean a sort of incarnation or a pantheistic form. It means that Allah has given to every human being something of a spiritual nature and the knowledge of God Almighty and coming closer towards Him. Here it refers to both Adam and Eve, may peace be upon them. Both were breathed something of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's spirits. Again we read in the Quran that Allah has appointed the human being as His vicegerent, as His trustee. And it is mentioned in Surah Isra, chapter number 17, verse number 70, which says, وَلَقَدْ كَرَّمْنَا بَنِي آدَمَ, that we have honored the children of Adam and bestowed on them special favors. Sorry. Here, all the children of Adam have been honored, male as well as female. There are some religious scriptures, for example the Bible, which puts the blame on Eve for the downfall of humanity. In fact, if you read the Quran in Surah Araf, chapter number 7, verse number 19 to 27, Adam and Eve, may peace be upon them, both are addressed more than a dozen of times. Both disobeyed God. Both asked for forgiveness. Both repented and both were forgiven. In the Bible, if you read Genesis chapter number 3, only Eve is held responsible, may peace be upon her, for the downfall of humanity. And according to the doctrine of original sin, because of Eve, may peace be upon her, the whole of humanity is born in sin. If you read the Bible in Genesis chapter number 3, verse number 16, it states that the God of the Bible, it is saying, unto the woman you shall bear in conception, and in sorrow shall you give birth, and your desire shall be of your husband, and he shall rule over you. That means pregnancy and childbirth has been said in the Bible to degrade the woman, and the labor pain is a sort of punishment. In fact, if you read the Quran, pregnancy and childbirth have uplifted the woman. If you read Surah Nisa, chapter number 4, verse number 1, it says, respect the womb that bore you. It's mentioned in Surah Luqman, chapter number 31, verse number 14. It says, وَوَسَيَّلْنَا الْإِنسَانَ بِوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانَ. That we have enjoined on the human beings to be kind to the parents. In travail upon travail did their mother bore them, and in years twain was their winning. A similar thing is mentioned in Surah Al-Kaf, chapter number 46, verse number 15. It again repeats, وَوَسَيَّلْنَا الْإِنسَانَ بِوَالِدَيْهِ إِحْسَانَ. We have enjoined on the human beings to be kind to his parents, to be kind to the parents. In pain did their mother bore them, and in pain did she give them birth. Pregnancy in the Quran has uplifted the woman, not degraded her. Just because pregnancy has uplifted the woman in Islam, will you call such rights in Islam as modernizing or outdated? The only criteria for judgment in the sight of Allah is taqwa, God consciousness or righteousness. It's mentioned in Surah Hujurat, chapter number 49, verse number 13. O humankind, we have created you from a single pair of male and female, and have divided you into nations and tribes so that you shall recognize each other, not that you despise each other. And the most honored in the sight of Allah is the one who is the most righteous. Sex, color, caste, wealth has got no criteria in Islam. The only criteria in the sight of Allah, it is taqwa. Neither is sex the criteria for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to reward or to punish a person. If you read Surah Imran, chapter number 3, verse number 195, it says, I will never suffer the lust of any of you, be it male or female. You are companions unto each other. I have started my talk by quoting a verse from the Quran, from Surah Al-Ahzab, chapter number 33, verse number 35, it says, Inna al-Muslimina wal-Muslimati. For Muslim men and Muslim women. وَالْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَالْمُؤْمِنَاتِ For believing men and women. وَالْكَانِتِينَ وَالْكَانِتَاتِ For devout men and women. وَالصَّادِقِينَ وَالصَّادِقَاتِ For true men and women. وَالصَّابِرِينَ وَالصَّابِرَاتِ For men and women who are patient and constant. وَالْمُتَصَدِّقِينَ وَالْمُتَصَدِّقَاتِ For men and women who give in charity. وَالْسَائِمِينَ وَالْسَائِمَاتِ For men and women who fast and deny themselves. وَالْحَافِذِينَ فُرُوجُهُمْ وَالْحَافِذَاتِ For men and women who guard their chastity. وَالْذَاكِرِينَ اللَّهَ كَثِيرًا وَالْذَاكِرَاتِ For men and women who engage much in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's praise. And the words end by saying, أَعَذَ اللَّهُ لَهُمْ مَغْفِرَةً وَأَجْرًا عَظِيمًا That for them, Allah has prepared forgiveness and ample of reward. This verse indicates that the spiritual duties, the moral duties for the men and women in Islam are the same. Both have to believe, both have to pray, both have to fast, both have to give zakat, etc., etc. But the woman has been given certain concessions in Islam. If she is undergoing her menstrual period or pregnancy, she does not have to fast. She can keep those fasts later on when she's more healthy. In fact, during the menstrual period and during the postnatal period, she need not pray also. She has been given the concession, and neither does she have to compensate it later on. Just because the moral duties of the men and women are equal in Islam, will you call such rights in Islam as modernizing or outdated? Let's analyze the economical rights. Islam gave economical rights to the women 1300 years before the West. an adult Muslim woman can own, she can dispose or disown any of her property without consulting anyone, irrespective whether she's married or she's single. In 1870, it was the first time in England that the West recognized the rights of the married woman, where she was allowed to own or dispose any of her property without consultation. I do agree that the women were given their economical rights 1300 years ago. These are ancient rights, but the question is, are they modernizing or outdated? A woman in Islam, if she wishes to work, she can work. There is no text in the Quran or the authentic Hadith which prevents or makes it prohibited for a woman to do any work as long as it is not unlawful, as long as it is within the purview of the Islamic Sharia, as long as she maintains her Islamic dress code. But naturally, she cannot take up jobs which exhibit her beauty and body, like for example modeling and film acting and such kind of jobs. Many of the profession and jobs which are prohibited for the woman are also prohibited for the man. For example, serving liquor, for example, working in gambling dens, for example, doing any unethical or dishonest business. All these jobs are prohibited for both men and women. A true Islamic society requires women to take up professions such as doctors. We do require female gynecologists. We do require female nurses. We do require female teachers. But a woman in Islam has got no financial obligation. The financial obligation is laid on the shoulders of the man in the family. Therefore, she need not work for her livelihood. But in genuine cases where there are financial crises in which both the ends don't meet, she has the option of working. Here too, no one can force her to work. She works out of her own absolute free will. Besides the profession I mentioned, she can work in the house and take up tailoring, she can take up embroidery, she can do pottery, she can make baskets, etc. She's also allowed to work in factories and small-scale industries in which has been designed exclusively for the ladies. She can work in places which have got separate sections, gents and ladies, because Islam does not agree with intermingling of the sex. She can also do business, and when it comes to doing transaction, where it involves interaction with a foreign male, with an ahram, she should do it through a father or a brother or a husband or a son. And the best example I can give you is of Bibi Khadija, may Allah be pleased with her, who was the wife of a beloved prophet, may peace be upon him. She was one of the most successful businesswomen of her times, and she did the transaction through her husband, Prophet Muhammad, may peace be upon him. A woman in Islam has been given more financial security as compared to the man. As I told you earlier, the financial obligation is not put on her shoulder. It is put on the shoulders of the man in the family. It's the duty of the father or the brother before she's married, and the duty of the husband or the son after she's married to look after lodging, boarding, clothing, and financial aspects of her. When she gets married, she is on the receiving end. She receives a gift. She receives a dower or a marital gift, which is called as mahar. As is mentioned in the Quran in Surah Nisa, chapter number 4, verse number 4, which says, وَآتُ النِّسَاءَ فَتُقَاتِهِنَّ نَحْلَةً Gift to the woman in door, a marital gift. For a marriage to solemnize in Islam, mahar is compulsory. But unfortunately, in our Muslim society here, we just keep a nominal mahar to satisfy the Quran. Say 151 rupees, or some people give 786 rupees. And they spend lakhs and lakhs of rupees on the reception, on the decoration, on the flowers, on the lunch parties, on the dinner parties. In Islam, there is no lower limit, nor is there an upper limit for mahar. But when a person can spend lakhs of rupees on the reception, surely the mahar should be much more. There are various cultures which have crept into the Muslim societies, especially in the Indo-Pak area. They give a small amount of mahar and they expect the wife to get a fridge, to get a TV set. They expect the wife to give a flat, to get a car, etc. and a large sum of dowry, depending upon the status of the husband. If he's a graduate, they may expect 1 lakh. If he's an engineer, they may expect 3 lakhs. If he's a doctor, they may expect 5 lakhs. Demanding dowry. A husband demanding dowry from the wife, directly or indirectly, is prohibited in Islam. If the parents of the girl give the girl something out of their own free will, it's accepted. But demanding or forcing, directly or indirectly, is prohibited in Islam. If a woman works, which she does not have to, whatever earning she gets, it is absolutely her property. She need not spend a single pie on the household. If she wants to spend, it's her free will. Irrespective how rich the wife is, it's the duty of the husband to give lodging, boarding, clothing, and look after the financial aspects of the wife. In case of divorce, or if a wife gets widowed, she is given financial support for the period of iddah. And if she has children, she's also given child support. Islam gave the right to the woman to inherit centuries ago. If you read the Quran in several verses, in Surah Nisa, in Surah Baqarah, and in Surah Maida, it is mentioned that a woman, irrespective she's a wife or she's a mother or a sister or a daughter, she has a right to inherit. And it has been fixed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran. And do know that are bound to be questioned that the inheritance law of Islam is unjust. But time does not permit me to clarify this. Inshallah, I will expect a question on this and then I can deal with this topic more in detail. Let's go further and analyze the social rights of a woman in Islam. Broadly, it can be categorized into 4 subheadings: social rights given to a daughter, to a wife, to a mother, and to a sister. Coming to the social rights given in Islam to a daughter. Islam prohibits female infanticide. The killing of female children is forbidden in Islam. It's mentioned in Taqweer, chapter number 81, verse number 8 and 9. When the female child is buried alive, and when she questions you, for what crime was she killed? Not only female infanticide has been prohibited, all sorts of infanticide have been prohibited in Islam, whether it be a male child or a female child. It's mentioned in the Quran, in Surah An'am, chapter number 6, verse number 151, that kill not your children for want of sustenance, for it is Allah that will provide sustenance for you and for children. A similar thing is mentioned in Surah Isra, chapter number 17, verse number 31, which says, kill not the children for want of sustenance, for it is Allah that will provide sustenance to you and the children. For killing of children is a major sin. In the pre-Islamic Arabia, whenever a female child was born, mostly she was buried alive. Alhamdulillah, after the spread of Islam, this evil practice has been discontinued. But unfortunately, it still continues in our country, India. According to a BBC report, in the program assignment, the title of which was Let Her Die, there was a British reporter by the name of Emily Buchanan who came all the way from Britain to India to give us the statistics of the female infanticide. This program was showed more than a year back on the Star TV, and alhamdulillah, it's been shown every month. And just a few days ago, it was again retelecast. In that program, it gives the statistics that every day, more than 3,000 fetuses are being aborted on being identified that they are females. If you multiply this figure by the number of days, that's multiplied by 365, you get a figure of more than 1 million female fetuses are being aborted every year in our country.